Welcome to the third Wealthy Boomer interview with Gordon Pape, author of Tax-Free Savings Accounts. Welcome back, Gordon.
Thank you, John.
So we're going to talk today, this time, about two interesting applications of the Tax-Free Savings Account, or TFSA. One is the way they can be used to get a down payment on a home, and the second is sort of as a supplement to the RESP. Let's talk about the Home Buyer's Plan one first.
Okay. A lot of questions that people are going to be asking are going to include, should I use these plans to save for a home, or should I do so in the RESP? And I do quite an in-depth analysis of this in the book to determine which is the better course. Now, let's say that you're in a situation where you want to get to the maximum $20,000 to be able to use against a down payment on a house as fast as you can. I say $20,000 because that's as much as you can take out of an RSP under the home buyer's plan, okay? So is it better to do that, or is it better to save the money in a TFSA? The conclusion I came to was, in this case, you're probably better to use the RSP. The reason is that essentially, if you start with $1,000 and you're in, say, a 30% tax bracket, if you put the money in the RSP, you've got $1,000 working for you right away. If you put the money in the TFSA, you only have $700 because it's after-tax dollars that goes into the TFSA, and people have to understand that. They pay the tax first, and then the money goes into the TFSA. This means that the actual amount in the RSP is going to accumulate more quickly. You're going to get to the $20,000 more quickly simply because that money has not been taxed away outside the plan. So it'll take fewer years for you to reach that $20,000 figure, and obviously the more money that you put into the plan, the faster you're going to get there. And that's why I think that it's a better route to go, because then when the money comes out for the down payment, it's not taxed. You're taking it under the home buyer's plan, and essentially it's interest-free, and you have 15 years to pay it back. Now, of course, if you really want to get there fast, you make the RSP contribution, you take the refund, you put the money in the TFSA, and then you got it working for you two ways.
And the other thing about the RSP is it's like four times the room. If you don't have a pension plan, and you have a certain amount of salary, right? I mean, you put in almost more than $20,000 versus
that's right. You can build it up at a much faster rate if you've got that much money to put into it.
And of course, you could use both in parallel. Mm-hmm. You could maximize your home buyer's plan out of the RSP while simultaneously accumulating in the TFSA.
Which is the best possible course, because obviously the more money you can put as the down payment on the house, then the lower the mortgage you're going to have to carry and the less interest you're going to have to pay.
Now, the related argument is the one about the RESPs. And I've noticed it's sort of interesting that the RESPs, Registered Education Savings Plans, sort of the last age you can kind of get the grant is 17, although you can continue to contribute to an RESP just for the tax-free compounding to, I believe, 25. Mm-hmm. But interesting that 17, just the moment when most parents will stop contributing to RSP happens to be the age, near the age, 18, when the child can enter have their own TFSA. So you can almost see the two working together.
Yes, you could very well. If you're dealing with, a lot depends on the age of the child. If you're dealing with a very young child and you're just starting out a plan, then the Registered Education Savings Plan, the RESP, clearly has the advantage, and it's basically for one reason, and that's because of the Canada Education Savings Grant. Because of that extra money that the government is going to kick into the plan in terms of your own contribution, it builds up the plan more quickly. In both cases, you're putting after-tax money into the plan. This is not like an RSP. You're not getting a tax deduction in either case for your contribution. So it's apples and apples in terms of what's going into the plan, but the Canada Education Savings Grant makes the difference. So for a younger child, you certainly want to go that route. Again, you can save in parallel with the TIFSA if you want to. Now, when you get to the case of older children, two things happen. Number one, if you're starting to save for a child who is, say, 16 and has never had an RESP, that child is not eligible for the Canada Education Savings Grant. At that point in time, you might as well use the TFSA because you're not getting any particular benefit out of using the RESP. Also, if you're getting to a stage at which the child is not going to go to university for another two or three years, and the child is 17, 18 years old, sure, you can set up your own TIFSA to help support the child, and the child can have their own plan as well, and you can give them the money to put into it and maximize the savings that way. So there are many permutations and combinations that you can use here to really maximize the education savings. The TIFSAs don't replace the RESPs. There is a supplement to them.
Because it's so complicated that, A, you need your book, but B, it sort of indicates the value of a financial advisor. To when you have to maximize the RESP, the RRSP, your non-registered saves, the TFSA, your pension plan.
You have all this stuff going on. One of the things I think the TFSA should perhaps eliminate is the whole idea of these in-trust accounts that have created a lot of problems for people. I think that this is something that people are going to want to look at again in a much more skeptical way now that they have the TFSAs to use as an alternative.
One final topic, Gordon. We've written about the seniors. Canadian seniors were forced to do RIF withdrawals from their registered retirement income funds in lieu of the stock market crash of 2008. One interesting thing is the TFSA is available to them, whereas they have the seniors over 71 have no other tax shelter.
Yes, that's right. And seniors who are receiving a reasonable income are constantly complaining to me about the high taxes that are assessed against the RIF withdrawals, and especially if they don't need to make the RIF withdrawals, if they have income from other sources and they'd rather keep the money in the plan. Well, we still can't get around those taxes, but at least what the TFSAs allow them to do is once the money comes out of the plan and it's taxed, then they can take $5,000 for each of them, as a couple say, so $10,000 in the first year, and at least tax shelter that money so that any future growth is going to be sheltered going forward down the road. It's going to take a few years, but after a while, these people could build up a fair amount of tax sheltered savings.
Yes, the theme song for our seniors will be Gimme Shelter.
That's right.
Thanks, Gordon. I hope that your book does very well. I know it's going to do very well, and hope to see you again later in the year.
Thank you, John.